This is Wafa Halam from Inside Arabia. I am extremely pleased today to welcome Professor Ilan Pape from the University of Exeter. He's professor of history and the author of 20 books. One of the most important one is The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine, which has earned him tremendous fame. And I'm extremely excited to have him talk with us today. Professor Pape, shall I call you Ilan?
Ilan, please, yes.
Ilan, I am so happy to have you here with us. Thank you so much for taking the time. So this is actually a very momentous day because I believe that today in Washington, in the city where I am, the Trump administration, President Trump, is welcoming officials from the UAE and Bahrain, and I believe Prime Minister Netanyahu, for the signing of this, I don't know what to call it, we can't really call it a peace deal since there were no war between the parties, but it is a sort of a normalization of relations, and they are really trying to make a very big deal of it. Which is not, you know, most people, a lot of analysts have said it's not very that important because those relations have been in effect for a very long time. What do you make of this?
Well, I think that there is some importance in it, but there's also an exaggeration about its importance in other respects. It is important in a way that helps the present Trump administration and the present, shall we call it, Netanyahu administration to present a development as if it validates their perceptions of how best to deal with the Palestine question. They claim that there's no need to negotiate with the Palestinians. They claim that the Arab world had enough of the Palestinians. They also claim that the Arab world is willing to normalize its relationship with Israel and is far more apprehensive of Iran than of Israel. I think all these assumptions will prove to be wrong in time. But for a moment, you know, before we can see the future, they try to say, you see, and they're quite confident, by the way, that Saudi Arabia will join in this development. Therefore, I think the importance is that it shows us exactly in which direction they're going to go from now on. So the big question, of course, for us is, A, if Trump loses the elections very soon, what is the Biden administration going to do? Is it going to adopt the same line? Is it going to suggest a counter deal to the deal of the century? And the second thing to watch, I think, is how far can Arab regimes go against the basic aspirations of their own societies when it comes to Palestine? I'm not a prophet, so I can't say that I know exactly how it's going to be. But I think that the assumptions on which this so-called achievement are based might prove to be wrong as we move into the future.
So basically what you're saying is that you think that there might be a change in policy slightly if Trump loses the election and Biden takes over. But at the same time, do you suppose that really America has really a say that much in a peace deal with the Palestinians anyway? I mean, in the past, it hasn't proved to be that effective anyway.
To be honest, I'm not that optimistic that the Biden administration would bring anything fresh to the table. Maybe a change of style, that's quite possible, which is not something to underestimate or underrate. But it's not significant. And to be honest also, and to be fair rather, with the Trump administration, in essence, what they did is not that different from what the previous administration did when it came to Palestine. Again, the talk was different, but the walk was quite the same.
The style.
Right, exactly.
The style.
I'm not optimistic, but I'm thinking that it would be interesting to see, at least because of the rhetoric of the Democratic Party, if they would really go on with this idea that you can totally ignore the Palestinians when it comes to the Palestine questions. They might do that. I'm not saying that they don't, but I think it would be a bit more difficult for them than it is for someone like Donald Trump, who doesn't care one way or another, does he? If I go deeper into this, if we look at this whole episode and we contextualize it together with the Trump deal of the century, not just the event that is taking place today in Washington, for me, the most profound conclusion one should draw from this is that the Palestinians need to probably internalize two facts of life that at least the Palestinian Authority finds very difficult to do. Understandably, but nonetheless, I think they will have to internalize it. The first fact of life is that America is a dishonest broker. And it's time to get as far as possible from a Pax Americana, from an American peace.
Yes.
Or for a dominant American role in the Palestine question. That's the first fact of life. I know it sounds for many people around the world, well, it's easy. It's not easy. If you put 50 years in Ramallah, even before the PA, or let's say at least from the 1980s, the late 1980s, Palestinian leaders were visiting only one capital when they wanted to achieve anything, which was Washington, after the end of the Cold War. It's not that easy to get out of it, but I think they will have to, because any day, every day that passes by that the United States is still playing a dominant role in the affairs of Palestine deepens the Palestinian catastrophe and disaster. The second fact that they have to internalize is that America is not the whole world. There's a whole world there which the Palestinians seem to ignore. And these are the Muslim countries like Indonesia, Malaysia, the countries in South America, South Africa. These countries are waiting for the Palestinians to say to them, you know, we have a different approach now because everything we have tried is not working. Israel is taking over the West Bank. Israel is sieging the Gaza Strip. Israel is running an apartheid state towards its own citizens. We are thinking about a different model, a model that would, you know, dismantle this regime. But we need your help. And this is our vision. Hopefully they will eventually adopt a vision that I believe in, which is a democratic state for all and not the two-state solution. But whatever they decide, it's up to them. I'm not a part of the
country. Yes.
They have to decide. But at least they need to have a clear vision for the future. And they don't need only the Americans there, or not even the Europeans. I think it's time for someone else to play a more major role as an outside intervention.
I think you really bring something very important. What the Trump administration basically has done is really sort of, again, shed the light and put some transparency in the fact that this is really where the U.S. stands when it comes to the Palestinian-Israeli questions. And I think in some interesting ways, it also shows where the Arab states stands. That in fact now I think it is time basically for the Palestinians to stand for themselves and take matters in their own hands instead of relying on outside parties to make the peace that they want. But for that to happen, as you well know, there needs to be unity within the Palestinian people. What do you think, what can we expect in that respect in terms of, you know, the Hamas controlling Gaza, which is an open air prison really, and the West Bank?
Yeah. First of all, I fully agree with you. The first preliminary step for any change in the rules of the game is a united democratic representative body of the Palestinians articulating the vision for all of us for the future. So even people like me as part of the progressive Jewish community in historical Palestine can say, okay, we are, tell us how we can help in that respect. Yes. I'm not very optimistic about the possibility of the present factions, that is Hamas and the Jihad on one hand, and the Fatah and the PA on the other, to present a united front on anything. But I think we should remember that the Palestinian society is one of the youngest in the world. I think half of the Palestinians, especially in the occupied territories, but also in other Palestinian communities, are below 18. And I think that younger generation is not necessarily Hamas or Fatah. Yes. I think that they are far more independent in their thinking, don't have strong affiliation to present political factionalism. And therefore, I think they might be the ones who would carry forward, maybe not immediately, but later on, a different vision and maybe a different constellation of political powers inside the Palestinian camp. So I don't think this will happen very soon, but there's nothing wrong in sort of flagging it out as the precondition for all of it. I fully agree. It's a precondition for all of it. In many ways, other things are already there. There is a public opinion outside in the world that is far more pro-Palestinian than it ever was before, manifested in support for the BDS. There is reality on the ground that has really kind of taken the wind out of the sails of the two-state solution. So there are many elements in this new political constellation which are already there, but I think they're useless or would not be significant if we won't have that kind of development within the Palestinian polity.
It seems there is a huge divide. I mean, when you think that half of the world Jewish population is in Israel, the other half is in America pretty much, that it's interesting that there is such a movement toward progressive views in the United States about the Palestinian questions being even more exacerbated, or I would say emphasized by the Black Lives Matter. I think more and more American Jews are beginning to think, or, you know, I like to think Americans of Jewish faith, beginning to think that they cannot, because they are really one of the segments that is the most liberal and progressive in America. And so the idea that you can be progressive with everything except when it comes to the Palestinian question is really kind of counterintuitive. Also, there have been more and more organizations, you know, taking people, showing them what's happening in the West Bank, because where I believe the Israeli government, the right wing in particular, have been so successful in is completely keep their population within Israel proper of the real situation in the West Bank and Gaza. Would you say that that's accurate, that there is really is that apartheid is not really only affecting the Palestinians, but also the Israeli population itself, which is completely ignorant of what their government is doing to the Palestinians?
Yeah. But first of all, I agree with what you said about the, especially the younger generation, American Jews. Definitely, they are less and less reliable as far as Israel is concerned for being kind of automatic supporters of the state of Israel. And I think Israel relies much more on Christian Zionists nowadays in America than it relies on American Jews. As for your second point, first of all, I think you're right. I think most Israeli Jews either are not interested in what goes on in the occupied territories, or are ignorant of what goes on. And part of the reason for this is indeed this segregation. They are not allowed to go, neither do they wish
they're
to go.
They're forbidden, right? I mean, they're not allowed.
Exactly. But there's something deeper here, which we have seen in apartheid South Africa. This is not just a response for a policy of a government that tries to hide or tries to convince you not to go to a place or not to know about a place. This is the result of 70 years of education, of indoctrination. You don't get this is an apartheid regime that is sustained by the fact that the vast majority of the Jews who live in Israel believe in its validity, in its moral, right. In its moral validity.
Yes.
So they have no problem. Yeah. Even if they know, they have no problem to see on television, not that they see that much. But even if they would be told that Palestinians are being humiliated at the checkpoint, or houses are being demolished, or people are being expelled, or that the siege on Gaza brings people to, you know, the brink of starvation, you will find very little compassion. I'm not saying everyone, I don't want to generalize.
Yes.
There is a small group, an important group, of conscientious Jews in Israel who I think are disturbed by these issues. And once we have that unified Palestinian vision for the future, I think that that group will grow in numbers. But for the vast majority of Jews, unfortunately, we're in a similar situation that we were to apartheid South Africa with the white community. The ANC was totally aware of the fact that by itself, despite everything that would be said around the world, none of the white of South Africa, not the majority of the whites of South Africa, would not think there's anything wrong with apartheid.
Right.
They started thinking that something was wrong with apartheid when the boycott came, when the struggle of the ANC began. I mean, there was a lot of pressure from inside and outside that eventually convinced them to give in. But not because they went through a moral kind of process by saying, oh my God, we are something which is morally wrong. And we have to accept it, that this is a situation the Palestinians are facing, and according to that, strategize towards the future.
I know you have always held this view that the only solution to the problem really is a one-state solution. And I think you've been one of the first ones to preach this, and you've got pretty much vilified for that notion because it is anathema to the idea of the Jewish state. But as far as we know now, the populations of the Palestinians is about 6 million people, and the population of the Jewish population is about 6 million people. That's about 50%. There is no other possibility, is there?
Not really. I mean, when you have a reality by which many parts of the West Bank have already been colonized by Jewish settlements, that you have the kind of demographic reality that you talked about, there are only two options. Either you sustain and maintain an apartheid state, where one group has all the privileges, and the other doesn't have any of the privileges or the rights, or a very limited number of rights and privileges, or you build a regime that is based on equality and democracy, and also one that corrects some of the evils of the past. Because in the particular case of Palestine, I think we have to integrate in our thinking about the future the right of return of the Palestinian refugees, because without at least acknowledging that right. I'm not talking yet about how technically or physically it would be implemented. It's possible, but of course it will take time to figure it out. But at least to accept it in principle is the only way of bringing this issue into a closure. Because I think without that, it's impossible to see any genuine reconciliation taking place between the Israelis and the Palestinians. So yes, I think that's the only possible solution. In many ways, you can say we already have a one state. We have one state. It's not a democratic state. It rules in different ways, different parts of historical Palestine. And it's much more a question of changing the regime than looking for a dramatic political solution. The structure is there, but it needs to be a different kind of regime, different kind of institutions have to be built in order to represent the values of democracy and humanity that the Palestinians have been robbed of for more than 70 years, if not longer.
You know, this is obviously, I think I've read many places that the majority of Palestinians really don't like the idea very much, neither do does the Israeli population. The idea of one state is still something very problematic for most, but again, like all ideas, you have to sort of put the seed and wait for it to germinate and grow.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's true, by the way. I think it was true about 15 years ago. I think that among the Palestinian refugees, definitely this is a popular idea. Among the younger generation of Palestinians in Israel, it is a popular idea. And it's the two communities, and understandably, were afraid that if you don't talk about two-state solution, you will not bring an end to the Israeli occupation, where the people of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. But I think also there, especially among young Palestinians, the realization begins to pop that the two-state solution, whether it's good or bad, is not a practical solution.
Not viable.
And will not end. And as we've seen through the implementation of the Oslo Accord, even when it is attempted, it does not bring an end to the Israeli occupation or military power in the life or imposition on the life of Palestinians. And therefore, I think it's, we don't have surveys, but I think if we would do a proper survey today, I don't know if it's a majority or not, but we will see a significant rise in the number of Palestinians, especially young Palestinians, who now support this idea compared to 10 or 15 years ago.
You're absolutely right. It is hard to imagine that at any point in time, Israel would accept to have a really independent Palestinian state, even with all the land swapping and stuff. But still, I mean, they estimate there is about 800,000 settlers in the West Bank, which is an enormous amount, which means that it's a fait accompli. The idea that the problem that I have, it's not so much, I think the Palestinians will probably be more open to the idea than the Israelis. And the idea of the Jewish state, the identity itself of the state, which is kind of anathema a little bit with the idea of democracy, isn't it? I mean, if we object to the Islamic Republic of Iran.
Yeah, that's right. That is right. Yeah. No, I think you're right. The Jewish society in Israel rejects the two-state solution as much as it rejects the one-state solution. It wants to continue to have a Jewish state.
Both ways.
Period. That's it. But I really think that this whole idea that you, and that's what we have been trying to do in the last 50 years, that you cannot move forward unless you first take care of the Israeli concerns. This was the formula until now.
Yes.
What are the basic Israeli concerns? And on the basis of these concerns, you build a model for a solution. And that was a total failure, I think it's time to try a different way. What are the main Palestinian concerns? And build a solution on that basis and see if the Israelis can accept it. We've never tried it. Because I think one of the basic Palestinian impulses, to my mind, is not statehood. I've never seen in the history of the PLO a particularly strong craving for a state.
Right.
I think the PLO, in all its years of liberation struggle, was fighting for the return of the refugees and the return for normal life all over Palestine. Mm. And only under duress and because of the change of the international constellation, it started to accept the idea of a state in the West Bank and in Gaza Strip. But again, I think, again, the international constellation has changed once more. And you need to adapt to these changes. You cannot be stuck with old ideas or recent ideas. You have to try and adapt. And I think in that respect, if the basis is Palestinian survival, normal life, justice, this, mm-hmm. if you start there,
yes.
political structure that comes out of it that you want the Israelis to convince, it would also benefit them.
Yes, yes.
To live in a democratic, safe country rather than in an apartheid country that is would be eventually pariah, not just among young people, but you know, they could find themselves totally delegitimized when a new generation of politicians will take over in different countries of the world.
Yeah.
People who would not be easily intimidated by the allegation of anti-Semitism, for instance, which is something you cannot use, by the way, in Latin America or Southeast Asia. That's another reason why the Palestinians should really look elsewhere for support in the rest of the world. So I think this is something that will be built from below, but is the only way forward, because the other alternative is the present reality, which is really dangerous for the Palestinians. It's almost like another, or as the Palestinians call it, they say in Arabic that they live in al-Nakba al-Mustamirra, that they live in this ongoing catastrophe. And I think that we need to find a way of stopping that ongoing catastrophe.
Right. I read somewhere you said something to the effect that it's actually would benefit, of course, the Israeli and the Israeli state as well, because it is like the Titanic. There was a comparison. I think it was an Al Jazeera interview. I'm not sure where you say.
Yes. I see it as a Titanic. I'll explain what I said. Yes, I said that there is a sense in Israel that they can be alienated and separated from the Middle East, as if they don't belong to the Middle East or the Arab world.
Right.
And they're just part of Europe. And I said that they are in the Middle East. They are part of the Arab world. Whether they like it or not is really irrelevant. Geographically, culturally, historically, they are in the midst of the Arab world. And the Arab world, I said, is like a big ship. Now, if this ship is going to a safe harbor and they can contribute to its navigation, to a safe harbor, everybody will be safe. But if this ship is going like the Titanic to be hit by an iceberg and drown, the fact that they think that they have the best cabin in the Titanic will not save them. Will not save them.
Right.
And this kind of Israeli mentality is really very weird in this respect. They really believe that they can challenge geography, you know, and history.
Yes.
Like Trump thinks that he can challenge climate
yes,
change.
Exactly.
There's something in common, these people, I think, in that respect,
It's really interesting when you think that return to the Holy Land, by definition, is in the heart of the Middle East and the Arab world. It just so happens to be that way, but still wanting to belong to Europe and being part of a European culture, because they are the power they are the ruling power. The ruling elite really is European Ashkenazi Druze. They're really seeing it as that's where they belong. But that is part of the colonial ethic, isn't it? You know, that we are better. Yeah. You know, these people are savages and they're backwards and they're Arabs.
it's not different from other settler colonial movements who were kicked out of Europe and tried to recreate a new Europe elsewhere.
Yeah.
And usually they encountered the presence of someone else in those places where they wanted to rebuild a new Europe. And in many places, as in the United States, they genocided the local population or imposed apartheid on them in South Africa. In Palestine, it's still going on, this idea that you can build a European Jewish state at the expense of the Palestinians and kind of hope that the Palestinians would evaporate or disappear. But it's not going to happen. And therefore, they can have as many bilateral agreements with any Gulf states that they want, the Palestinians would be there and they would have to find a way of framing the relationship with this native population if they want really to live as a normal group of people and not, hold the strongest army in the region because they feel so insecure because they refuse to accept where they are and who they are.
Would you say, do you have hope? Do you feel like there is movement towards a better sense of wanting to have a better world? And I'm speak from where you are in Israel.
Yeah, I'm by nature a hopeful person. So, and I think activists should be hopeful persons. Yes, not so much because of changes within the Jewish society. I draw my kind of strengths and empowerment from the younger Palestinian community. I think it's a very educated group of people, of young people, very knowledgeable, very politicized, committed, with excellent global connections, maybe because they are part of this age of internet that we're talking about, and they have a web kind of a network of identification with other struggles in the world. And I think that I'm very hopeful that this kind of group that puts human rights and civil rights at the very center of what they're doing would have an impact not just on Palestine, but also on the Middle East as a whole. There is a need for that kind of an influence. And so I think it will take time, but I feel that they have the strengths and the commitment to do it, but we should all lend our help as much as we can to make it happen.
Yes, I entirely agree. And on this beautiful words, I thank you very much for your time. It was wonderful to talk to you. I hope to hear more from you. You're always welcome. I would be very happy to host you again anytime.